New Mexico's very first newspaper was printed more than a half century before the United States officially conferred statehood on the land of enchantment. As you might guess, El Crepúsculo de la Libertad, the Dawn of Liberty, was also a Spanish language newspaper. It is part of the landscape of race and media discussed in a new book. We are joined by Juan Gonzalez and Joseph Torres, authors of News for All the People, the epic story of race in the American media. Joseph works with the media reform group Free Press, and some of you will no doubt recognize Juan as the co-host of Democracy Now! With Amy Goodman. This book is a history of the American media, everything from El Crepúsculo to ESPN. That history can't be told without telling the story of racial relations, of course. Was race or ethnicity a major factor in American media right from the start? Let's find out. Juan, thank you for coming to our studios. We really appreciate
you
being here.
Yes.
As we record this, you guys were both at UNM a little earlier in the week, and you had a knockout crowd, so congratulations and good for you. Take us through the book in News for All the People. It's interesting to me how many newspapers and broadsheets were out there in the American consciousness early in this country's founding. I think most folks would be surprised by that, actually.
Well, yes, it is amazing that from the colonial times and then in the early years and decades of the Republic, there was a huge explosion of newspapers in America, not only among the white population, mm-hmm. settlers, but even among people of color, because there was a government policy that basically subsidized the press in America, mm-hmm. through something called this old-fashioned thing that people consider a relic today, the postal system. People say, oh, the postal system, why does it even exist anymore? We have email, we have all these other forms of communication. Well, the reality is the postal system was America's first internet. Mm-hmm. It was the way that news and information flowed throughout a vastly expanding country. And because the government early on, when it created the post office, when Congress created the post office, decided that there would be subsidized delivery of newspapers, it was possible if you could print a paper, the government would deliver it for you through the postal system. Mm. And so, for instance, the city of New Orleans had 25 Spanish language newspapers before the Civil War, wow. including a daily. Huh. Right. There were more than 30 African-American newspapers, beginning with Freedom's Journal in New York City in 1827. There were Native American newspapers. There were Chinese newspapers, 25 of them, before the beginning of the 20th century. Mm. And so there was a vibrant press by people of color, and also there was obviously a much bigger press in America. Mm-hmm. Our country had more newspaper circulation per capita than any country in the history of the world in the 19th century. And it was because of a government policy because our founders believed that the widest possible dissemination of news and information was crucial for the defense and the progress of our republic. Mm-hmm. So that was a policy, and the result of that policy was this vibrant press. But the press of people of color is almost unknown. The local libraries never preserved the copies. Mm. The local universities never saved them. And so many of these papers have been lost and forgotten because there are no surviving copies or few copies. So when you're trying to piece together, because journalism, many have said, is the first draft of history. Mm. So if you're a historian going back to write about what happened in New Mexico or in Arizona, and the only papers that you have to refer to for the events of the day are the papers of the Anglo settlers, but not of the Mexicans that had been on this land during that period, then you don't have a complete picture, mm-hmm. of that history. So that's why this press is so important.
Absolutely. Joseph Torres, good to see you. Thank you for coming. How was lunch at Serafine, by the way?
Excellent.
You like green chili?
I had red.
You had red. That's good enough. That's okay. First time in New Mexico. I appreciate that. Based on what Juan just said, what happens when those other voices don't get heard in real time? Not necessarily looking back in history and trying to get an understanding, but in real time, what happens if those voices are muted?
Well, I mean, historically, our people of color have fought to try to make sure the voices of their community are being heard. When we cannot speak for ourselves, when other people speak for us, it causes great harm. It's almost, you know, what I'm just saying, it's almost like a replication of what the Freedom's Journal, the first African-American paper, published in his inaugural issue. Today, you know, historically, you know, we have not been able to own media properties, particularly in broadcast media when it comes to radio and television stations. cable networks. Today, we only own 3% of all TV stations, people of color, 1% for Latino, even less, way under 1% for African Americans. Mm-hmm. African Americans only own like 5 or 6 stations in the whole country. 8% of all radio stations, women only own 6% of broadcast stations. Mm. So when other people control the narrative, and it's the reason why we are marginalized, it's the reason why most stories that affect our community don't get covered. The only story you hear about is immigration. And and with that is the negative aspect of immigration and how we're all a threat to society. And the issue of being a threat to society is a theme that Juan and I have wrote in this book, plays out all throughout history. That the people of color have always been the other, have always been the threat to society, and it continues to play out because we don't control our own message.
And speaking of threats, it must have been an enormous threat to have those voices out there. And as documented in the book that you guys have out, this was not an easy ride, certainly, to be a publisher of color in those times. I mean, there were things that happened that were just, you know, beyond the pale.
Yeah. Well, and there were repeated examples of people, folks who were persecuted, their newspapers shut down, their newspapers burned down. Mm-hmm. I mentioned the press in New Orleans before the Civil War. There was a great newspaper there, Patria, which was opposed to the Mexican-American War, but it was now in the United States, and it was opposing territorial expansion of the country. So what happens in 1851, a mob marches down to the newspaper offices and destroys the presses and riots in the Latin Quarter of New Orleans. Mm. The same thing happened with Ida B. Wells in Memphis. In Memphis, Tennessee, she was using her paper to expose lynching of black men in her town, and the white citizens of the town immediately put pressure to close down her newspaper. Mm-hmm. The same thing happened to Ricardo Flores Magón, an early 20th century newspaper editor who was producing papers throughout the Southwest, critical of the Porfirio Diaz government in Mexico, but the government in Mexico, the dictatorship there, was friendly with the U.S. government, and the U.S. government kept persecuting Ricardo Flores Magón, finally arrested him on sedition charges, sentenced him to Leavenworth prison, where he died in prison, a newspaper editor, shut down because he spoke inconvenient truths right here in the United States. And there are many examples of these editors who stood up in difficult situations to say, no, somebody has to talk about justice and equality, not just with the general population of the country, but these particular nationalities, even with Native Americans. Mm-hmm. How many people know that Native Americans had their own press as early as 1828 with the Cherokee Phoenix, and that newspaper constantly wrote articles opposing Indian removal from the South, but the citizens of Georgia, the white settlers of Georgia, finally, after 8 years of this newspaper publishing, rode into town one day and destroyed its presses. Mm. So, and it ceased to exist until the Cherokee Advocate developed in the Indian Territory about a decade later. So we have this situation throughout American history of these are heroes of journalism who stood up in difficult times and faced persecution, faced jail, faced the destruction of their presses because they dared to say something that others didn't like.
One of the parts of the book that really caught me as I got through it a little bit is what happened in Wilmington, the situation in Wilmington, Delaware, I believe. And the
Wilmington coup, right? Yeah. The Wilmington coup of 1898. Mm-hmm. This is, to me, is the most astonishing example because it was directly organized by a newspaper publisher. But in 1898, toward the tail end of the Reconstruction period, when white supremacists were once again regaining control of the South and ousting elected black officials and their Republican allies in the South, the city of Wilmington was a majority black city with a majority black elected city council. And in November of 1898, several thousand armed whites marched into the town. They burned down the local black newspaper. They rounded up all of the elected black officials at gunpoint and ordered them out of town. And they appointed a former Confederate colonel to be the new mayor of Wilmington, North Carolina, and they then proceeded to attack the black community. More than 60 people were killed, 60 African Americans were killed in the violence that ensued, but no one was ever arrested. Wow. This was the only successful armed coup in American history of a local government. No one was ever arrested. No one was ever brought to justice. But the whole thing, the principal leader was Josephus Daniels, the editor and publisher of the Raleigh Observer, the most respected newspaper publisher in the state, who later became Secretary of the Navy during World War I under Woodrow Wilson, later became ambassador to Mexico under Franklin Delano Roosevelt in the 1930s. He was a major political figure, yet he was involved in murder, arson, the destruction of a fellow press, of an African American, and he boasted about it.
Wow.
So this is part of what I call the lurid scandal of American journalism, mm-hmm. where newspapers and radio stations not only disseminated bigoted views, but actually organized and instigated acts of violence, race riots and massacres. Mm-hmm. And until we come to terms with this checkered history of American journalism, we're not going to be able to really assure a fair and just system, because we have not dealt with the legacy of the damage that this kind of journalism has done throughout American history.
Interesting. No one's ever paid a price for this in publishing circles, have they? Back then, people just generally got away with things like this.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, Josephus Daniels is celebrated as a great journalism figure.
Wow.
In textbooks and throughout history. And it's only been recent years, as Juan was saying, that mm-hmm. a few newspapers, the Tallahassee paper, as a Tallahassee paper that apologized for not covering the civil rights movement after Rosa Parks, launched the bus boycott and boycotts were happening in other cities. So, this is what's happening. You know, the Kerner Commission in 68. This is not nothing. This is, even though this happened in the 1800s. You know, we still have this happening within recent years. The Kerner Commission in 68 showed that papers played an active role in fueling the misinformation that contributed to all these racial riots, about 1,100 racial riots that happened in over a two-year period in the late 60s.
Wow.
WLPT, Juan and I was in Los Angeles yesterday. We got to meet Mega Everett's son just by coincidence, and a lot of he went on a station in Jackson, Mississippi in 1963, I believe, in WLPT. And he, you know, a great civil rights leader, but many people have never saw his face before, mm-hmm. or heard him speak. They see him, read about him in the paper. And people warned him, they were concerned about his safety mm-hmm. when he went on the air to challenge a station that allowed white supremacists on the air to oppose integration of the South, but would not allow folks from the black community to come in and challenge those views. He was able to get on the air and challenge those views. And literally within three weeks later, he was shot dead. And a lot of people believe his appearance on those airwaves contributed to that. And I take it up to the present day. You know, hate speech is still very much a part of today's society, particularly in talk radio and for the Latino community. Hate crimes is up 40% against Latinos. And a lot of people attribute that to the toxic talk on the radio. So it's still very much an issue today, the question of speech and how it's used against people
sure.
of color.
One of the things that we're all old enough to remember, the heyday of the Weekly, that would do great things. Village Voice was, you know, rocking and rolling. Boston, Phoenix, where I grew up, all that kind of thing. Where do you think, has something come off the edge for weeklies in your view around the country, or is that good kind of journalism where, frankly, people ended up in jail from weeklies years ago? Could we still anticipate that kind of thing for weeklies these days?
Well, the weeklies, unfortunately, many of the successful weeklies have gone through the same kind of media concentration that exists for the big dailies and for the television stations. So, for instance, the old Village Voice and New Times and in Florida and all of these others have been bought up by chains now. What do the chains of the weeklies do? They do the same thing that the other commercial press do. They make more money by reducing their news staffs,
right.
By reducing the number of people who are actually reporting. So all of these great reporters at people like the Village Voice have been laid off in recent years. The Ridgeways and the Nat Hentoffs and the Wayne Barretts have all been pushed out because the owners of the new Village Voice don't feel they need that. But this is happening throughout, that unfortunately, and this is one of the themes of our book, mm-hmm. that what happens in the media in the United States is that every time a new communications technology is developed, it subverts the existing order. And suddenly the old media system has to adapt or die. And new rules have to be established for how news and information will flow in the United States. And therefore, Congress has to step in with new laws. It happened when the telegraph came about in the 1840s. It happened when early amateur radio developed in the early 1900s. It happened later on when cable television came. And it's now happening with the internet. So all print newspapers, all TV stations, all radio stations are now being destabilized, and they feel themselves under threat by the internet, which is the merger of all previous mediums, mm-hmm. because now video, voice, and print have all merged in this new platform and with no borders. So that the question is, what kind of laws will the government pass to deal with this latest technological revolution that will determine how news and information flows to the citizens of this country? Mm-hmm. And there are many major issues which we deal with in the book. What are the new issues in this new era of the digital age? And what will be the impact on the old media? Because some people say the old media is going to die. Well, that's not true. When FM radio came into existence decades ago, everyone predicted that AM radio was going to die. Well, hey, AM radio is still here. Right. What happened is that the owners repurposed their radio stations, segmented their audiences, and then they figured they'd get the big money out of FM radio, but they were still getting some money out of AM radio. And in fact, that change opened up opportunities for African Americans, because then what happened is owners decided, okay, we've been ignoring the black community, but now that we have FM radio, we can use our AM stations to reach the black community, a new market. So you started having black appeal radio and black disc jockeys all over the country. And it was as a result of the fact that the AM stations were no longer as valuable to the media system. Mm-hmm. So we have these opportunities sometimes when there's a transition into new technologies of information, that it opens up other opportunities for people who have been marginalized. It's just a question of being able to analyze the system, figure out what are the government policies that will be of best benefit to people of color and to working people and to marginalized groups, and fight for those, fight for Congress and fight for the government to pass policies that all the people will have access to news and information, mm-hmm. not just a few and the privileged. Mm-hmm.
Joseph, real quick, we're a little short on time, but we've got to get in net neutrality.
Sure.
Your work with the Free Press, where do we stand now, and what are the issues there?
Well, net neutrality, the FCC in December passed net neutrality rules that basically do not protect wireless users. Okay. Right now, for wireline users, the rules pretty much apply that the ISPs cannot interfere with your traffic, the Verizon, the AT&T, Comcast. Mm-hmm. But those rules don't necessarily apply to wireless. Mm-hmm. They can actually slow down the ability of people to actually access websites of their choices. Verizon is suing the FCC because the FCC did a poor job of passing this law on solid legal ground. It's a good chance the rules are going to get overturned by the court, and we're going to have to refight this again at the FCC. Mm-hmm. One last thing on this,
please,
is that unfortunately we need more help from our community. There's groups like the Media Literacy Project here in New Mexico fighting for an open internet, but not enough of our historical civil rights groups are. Mm-hmm. They are siding with the telecom companies, and which is we need to hold them accountable to make sure they do the right thing by our community. So that's pretty much where we stand.
Sure, absolutely. And Juan, on that note too, net neutrality is not the only thing. Certainly we've got all kinds of things that are legacies from the Patriot Act. We've got phone companies and publishers who have got a little fingerprint in there and helping these things along. Look at what just happened in Germany. The German government has just confessed about the whole thing they can do to spy on people through their own webcams.
That's a major issue in the digital age, the degree to which we will fight to have government limits on surveillance, on the ability of government to shut down websites. We've seen what happened with WikiLeaks and the mm-hmm. enormous problem that they've had as pressure was put onto companies not to process donations to them. There's all kinds of ways that the issue of surveillance and government control of the new media, and there's also public access.
Right.
Public access has always been historically very important for people of color and marginalized groups to be heard. But yet under the new systems that are developing, the cable companies want to ghettoize and starve public access by not giving them sufficient funds, even though the cable companies are making more money than anyone can imagine, because they are now no longer just providing video service to you over your cable system. They're providing phone service and they're providing internet service, but they're only paying fees to local governments over their video service. And meanwhile, they're not paying anything over their phone and internet service back to the community so that public access can be expanded.
AT&T, Google, these telecom companies are now a major part of the defense and military industry when it comes to surveillance. We don't know enough about this. Mm-hmm. Dana Priest, I believe, from the Washington Post has done a lot of reporting on this. We need to know more about how Googles and the Facebooks and particularly AT&T and Google as well, as you said, Google, but that they are their government they actually receive government contracts to do surveillance, and we need to keep an eye on this.
Mm-hmm. I got to say congratulations. This is a terrific book, not just for certainly history nerds or news nerds. That's not even the point. The point is about how voices in this country have always been there. This book is just incredibly timely, and I thank you both for being here and just sharing this with us. News for All the People, the epic story of race in the American media, and it's out now. Joseph Torres, Juan Gonzalez, once again, thank you both. We are thankful as ever for you, the viewers. It's your interest in public affairs, your love for politics, good books, a good film, just a good discussion that keeps us going every week. Now, we're back next week ready to handle the holiday season. I'm Gene Grant. We'll see you then in Focus.